Radio. Across the UK. Online. On DAB. And on your smart speaker. The Unexplained. With Howard Hughes. On Talk Radio. Talk Radio. Talk Radio.
Hour three. The rise and rise of conspiracy theories. We ask how they start, and we check out some of the biggest ones with researcher Andy Thomas. That's after midnight tonight. You can connect with us anytime on 03444991000 on the phone, at Talk Radio on the Twitter, or you can text Talk and then a space in your message to 87222. So get set for resourcefully rapid-fire rollercoaster randomised reality radio for a Sunday night. This is The Unexplained, Dateline October the 18th, 2020.
The Unexplained with Howard Hughes.
Now, we're going to talk about conspiracy theories in the next hour with author and researcher Andy Thomas. We'll talk about a lot of the common conspiracy theories and why this is the era of them with Andy Thomas coming next here on The Unexplained, only from Talk Radio.
Talk Radio. Talk Radio. Talk Radio. Across the UK. Online. On DAB. And on your smart speaker. The Unexplained with Howard Hughes on Talk Radio.
The Unexplained hits midnight, which means that we're into Monday morning, the start of another week. And whichever tier you happen to find yourself in the United Kingdom, I'm talking coronavirus for my international listeners here, whichever tier you're in, I hope this week is not too trying for you. And I hope it's maybe better than last week. But let's see, we can never make any predictions, even though sometimes I've had psychics on this show. My own psychic abilities are sadly lacking, so let's just hope for the best, hey? Thank you very much for all of your emails and correspondence during this week, by the way. Always pleased to hear from you. If you want to connect with me quickly, easiest way to do that is to go to my website, theunexplained.tv. You can follow the link from there and you can send me a message. Or if you would like to commune with my Facebook page, it's the official Facebook page of The Unexplained with Howard Hughes. Whichever way we look at it, we've got you covered. Now, after midnight, we do, as you know, tend to have deeper conversations about a variety of topics. They don't all have to be spooks and UFOs. Tonight, we're going to talk about conspiracy theories. It is an era that we live in that is absolutely, as they say, replete with them. I mean, you don't have to be, you know, you don't have to be on social media for very long when you will see somebody peddling what one person may call a conspiracy theory and what someone else may call the truth. That is the era in which we live. But they have a history and they have a background. And a man who's tried to decode what conspiracy theories in general are all about is Andy Thomas. Andy Thomas is one of the UK's leading researchers into unexplained mysteries and conspiracies. I'm reading his biography here. His many other books include the acclaimed The Truth Agenda, Exploring Paranormal Phenomena and Global Cover-Ups, and Vital Signs, which has been described as the definitive guide to the crop circle phenomenon. We have to talk about that sometime. He's online to us now at The Unexplained from his base in Sussex. Andy, how are you?
I am fine, and thank you very much for having me here.
Well, thank you for coming on. You appear to cover a great deal of ground. How would you, I've read those couple of lines from your biography, but how would you best describe yourself?
I mean, I think for me, one thing has led to another, and as you acknowledge there, you know, I came into this really going into the unexplained areas. So things like UFOs and crop circles, that was my entry into this world. And of course, you soon realise that whatever anybody thinks about those things, the truth is not being told about them in the media. So that kind of made me realise, well, if they're not telling the truth about something as basic as these things, we can be fairly sure they're not telling the truth about other things. And then, of course, you meet people studying other areas, and conspiracy theory was something which very quickly came my way. And I realized, yeah, there are cases to be made. Like, you know, we're encouraged to ridicule the paranormal. Well, we're encouraged to ridicule conspiracies. And yet you look back and you find there's a longevity to this being around. And there are reasons why people believe it. They're not all evil. They're not all mad. And, you know, that opened me up to needing to know more. more. And here I am today, still trying to get balanced conversations about it, because many of them are not balanced, as I'm sure you know. Mm.
You said that many of the topics in paranormality that we discuss here regularly, like UFOs, tend to be poo-pooed or shunned or not properly covered by the mainstream media. Do you think that that is still the case in those subject areas in 2020? I think there's a lot more coverage now, isn't there?
There is, but interestingly, only last week, I won't name it, but a well-known BBC comedy show had a comedian that make a joke saying that there were effectively no crop circles this year because of COVID, ho-ho, and it's not true. And actually, we had one of the better years for crop circles that we've had for a while. So, you know, that kind of stuff goes out unchallenged. And you think, why? It doesn't take long these days to check a website and just look at the basic facts of how many things like that are going on. But still, they will say things like that. And it's left to stand in the public gaze, which I think is wrong. And of course, you know, this happens with all kinds of areas as well. So, no, yeah, debunking is still alive and well.
Well, that was a comedian, of course. Maybe we can forgive a comedian. But if the mainstream media, in terms of news and factual programming, said that there haven't been any crop circles this year because of COVID, then they're completely wrong. Because I know, and we've mentioned a couple of them on this show over the months, that, you know, it has been a bit of a bumper year. And I think Wiltshire has been, once again, crop circle central. So not true in this case.
No, that's right. And I mean, it's not the first time that the media has tried to claim that it's all finished. I mean, in fact, I mean, back, I think in 2006, that was the first year where a number of newspapers ran the big stories officially declaring crop circles over. And then you looked at the actual database and you found there were loads of very wonderful formations that year. And it's a story that they've repeated over the years. So when they run out of news, they run a news story saying nothing's going on, which I always find rather amusing. But it is true, and sadly we see this same technique, if you like, of distraction going on in many areas, especially conspiracies, of course.
Well, conspiracy theories, thanks to social media, I think, the fact that, you know, many people who in the past had never had a voice have now got one, are absolutely burgeoning. And I would be the last person to say that we should be getting rid of electronic communication like we have in social media, because it's given me a platform. And, you know, in the days when I went into radio, if you found yourself not having a gig or a job, then there was no outlet for you. There was no, unless you made tapes and handed them out at train stations, your voice was silenced. Of course, these days, you know, whatever happens, if you have some technical ability, some equipment in my field, you know, you stay on air, whatever happens. So I would not knock social media and electronic communications. But the fact of the matter is, in this era of conspiracy theories, a lot of people have been empowered to propound them, which is a bit of a clumsy sentence, by the fact that they now have access to channels of communication they did not have before.
I think that's quite right. I mean, obviously, social media opened a door that I don't think anybody expected. I certainly think to the authorities, the genie came out of the bottle before they realized what was going on with the internet. They're now desperately trying to stuff it back in there. And I mean, one thing we have seen, and I've written about this, especially in the new version of my book, Conspiracies, I've added quite a lot of stuff in here, which is about online censorship. And that was building up dramatically even before the pandemic struck, and people were being deplatformed, being taken offline, not for espousing legal views, but just views that authorities don't seem to want us to be talking about. And then, of course, when the pandemic struck, and then people started to come up with all their theories about that, they could then justify taking even more things offline in the name of public health. Well, and it's now...
It depends on where you draw that line, though, doesn't it, Andy? Sorry to jump in here. You know, if something that has been put online, you know, especially at a time of national emergency, and look, you know, I'm going to get people shouting at me saying, listen to Howard Hughes, spokesman for the mainstream media. If you knew me, you would know that ain't so. But, you know, the fact is that some things that have been put out there have been potentially dangerous and might have encouraged people into behaving into ways that would have put them at risk one way and another. But, you know, I take the point that that you make, that, you know, deplatforming now is very much a tool, and some people have found themselves without a voice for the things that they have said. I'm not sure, and I'm not a lawmaker, thank God. I'm not sure where that particular line needs to be drawn. There needs to be a line, but I would not like the job of having to decide where you put that line.
Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that you don't need to be slightly sensible about these things, but I think it is a conversation that we should have. But yeah, where is that line? But the conversation isn't had, and the decision about the line, which is pushed back beyond where it should be, they seem to be made without any great public discussion.
Do you think that there should be a more or less 95% open house then, that people should be allowed to say online, in forums, in platforms, whatever they want? The problem with that is, of course, that some people don't have the greatest critical faculties. Now, you know, look, I'm not tarring everybody with this brush, but, you know, some people, if they see a thing posted online, they think, whatever it is, it's the truth because it's online. It looks solid and real, and, you know, it's got as much prominence as something that I read on the BBC or something else. So they think that it's truth. That's our difficulty, isn't it? That if you allow everything out there, some people are not going to exercise critical judgment in perhaps the way that they should.
Well, I mean, of course, some people would argue that the fact that something's on the BBC means that's the least likely thing to be true. So you can argue that one round the other way. No, discernment absolutely is very, very crucial. Discernment and evidence. And something I've always called for and in my writings is you've got to have some evidence. You know, you can have a belief, but if you put that round social media without any backup at all, that's all it is. It's a belief. And people do need to, I think, try to stack up some evidence at least before they take a certain path. But, you know, I just want to add here that we do have laws. Nobody is advocating hate speech. You know, anybody that says anybody should be harmed or their reputation or physically, whichever way you want to look at it, we have laws that deal with that. And no, absolutely, you can't have that. That way lies anarchy. But the expression of an opinion that is made in a reasonable way, even though it might not fit with the official view, I think should be allowed, you know, as long as people are respecting the rule of law. And we have a good rule of law here, and many other countries do. So, yes, I think we all know when lines get crossed. But at the moment, things are being taken down when they clearly haven't crossed that line.
I think you're dead right. And what needs to be done is that those who want to put things out there, you know, they have to think, OK, where's my evidence? Who can I cite? And are these people real? And, you know, am I able to draw upon them? And, you know, maybe if I gave their email address to an investigative journalist, they can look into these claims. You know, there has to be, just as when you're writing a news story, you have to have, you know, a couple of sources, you have to confirm the thing. That also goes with stuff that people put out there. And, you know, I'm very much a free, you know, people, there will be people who knock me, and I know they do. It is a tough line that I walk. I believe in free speech, but free speech has to have some limits. You can't just go and say anything out there because, as you said, thereby lies anarchy.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. But I think most people do respect those lines. We know there are some that don't, but we do have the laws already to deal with that, and you then have to apply them. But I think we've got to a stage now where it's as if the authorities have realised that it's very easy just to say, ah, that's fake news, because they don't like what's being said. And they hope that in the eyes of what they would see as the average public, that therefore they will assume that there can't be any truth to it. And as we know, that is sometimes simply not the case. So it's that putting everything into the same box and trying to close the lid that I think is the difficulty here. You know, we need to have a little bit more separation between what we are allowed to discuss. But yeah, certainly I understand why in these times of all times, you know, there has been a worry that people might be put off taking the necessary steps to, say, you know, restrict the pandemic. But some of the views, you know, which do challenge the way the data is being compounded, which do worry about the origins of the pandemic and so on, I think people should be allowed to discuss that, because I don't see how some of that is affecting people's responses to it necessarily.
No, so, you know, people should be allowed to ask questions. They absolutely should. And, you know, if they are barred from asking questions, then we're in a very bad place. No, the right to question must always be there, long as you can back it up with absolute fact.
well, or at least a reasonable case. You know, absolute fact, of course, is the problem we have. That's what's always being argued about. But if you can make a reasonable case and stack the evidence up so it goes above a certain level where you think this really needs looking at, then I would always be willing to consider review. That's how I've always said it. If there's no evidence, then, you know, it, like I said, it's just somebody's whim. And they're entitled to it, but I'm more interested in the ones for which there is clearly a serious case to be made.
Okay, we have a couple of minutes in this segment. We've got to give the definition, I think, in your book and in your research. What is a conspiracy theory?
So, I mean, conspiracy theory has become a phrase which now gets ridiculed. But the reality is conspiracies are purely just actions of people working as a group, usually for something nefarious. And a theory is where you have to try to fill in the gaps when you might not know the whole story. So therefore, I've always thought conspiracy theorizing actually seems perfectly reasonable, but of course it's now become a term of abuse, and I think that needs reclaiming, actually, because what happens is you've only got to say that phrase conspiracy theorist, and the hope is that somebody will think anybody that's down that road is mad. But if you just look at the dictionary definition of it, there's really nothing wrong with it at all. We don't always know what's going on. We do need to theorize, and we know conspiracies do exist, as history shows, and as my book Conspiracies, you know, goes into some detail. Conspiracy theory and conspiracies, it's not new. It's been with us for a very long time.
We'll talk more about the history of conspiracy theories with Andy Thomas coming next here on The Unexplained. Stay here.
Talk Radio. The Unexplained with Howard Hughes on Talk Radio.
In the nighttime, The Unexplained with Howard Hughes. Andy Thomas is here. We're talking about the difficult but fascinating topic of conspiracy theories. And, Andy, conspiracy theories have a much longer history than many of us may have thought. I mean, most of us, you know, born at a particular time into this modern contemporary era that we're in, probably think that conspiracy theories started with JFK, but they would be wrong, yeah?
Oh, they would be very wrong. I mean, there's also a general myth out there that conspiracy theories only began with the internet. Well, you can probably go back to the earliest times and you're going to find conspiracy theorists. I mean, the Roman times, I think they're always a good starting point because, I mean, their, you know, entire structure of power was riven with conspiracies, genuine ones and claims of it, and assassinations left, right and center that, you know, make the JFK plot look positively straightforward. And that's the thing. I mean, if you take the classic image of the Emperor Nero, who was always shown playing music while Rome burns, that is a conspiracy theory because, of course, the accusation was from Roman writers at the time that he had given the orders to set light to Rome because he wanted to rebuild it in his own way. And that's why he's always shown looking very happy about it. So, you know, you've got a classic conspiracy theory there. And then we have phrases that we still use today, like false flag. So a false flag attack is when something, you know, it looks like one faction doing it, but actually it's a deflection because somebody else is. And it comes from the ancient times when fleets would dress their own ships up in the colours or the style of the enemy, or they would even hijack ships of the enemy, but then use those ships to attack their own fleet and make it look like the enemy had done it. So that's why it became known as false flag. But of course, people think false flag still goes on today, albeit not quite so obviously. So you've got this history of it. And then, of course, when they create the printing press, you know, we talk about fake news like that's a new phenomenon. It really isn't. People were putting out fake news pamphlets from the first day print was involved. So this is the thing. You look back and you find many, many conspiracy theories, any era you care to mention, and it's rife. And public belief in it has always been high, and it's always been quite a popular topic of discussion. So this notion that we've all been corrupted by the internet today, it is simply false. This has always been with us in one form or another.
And where do simple disagreements on points of fact end and conspiracy theories begin then? That seems to be a very fine line, doesn't it?
It does, and I think one of the issues we've always got is the interpretation of evidence. And very often, you know, you're relying on eyewitness evidence or, you know, hearsay, and that's always problematic. But I think that's when it gets interesting, when you've got events like 9/11, which I know is very controversial, but where you have film, where you have many eyewitnesses who were on record on the day being interviewed, saying things that simply do not concur with the official record. And plus, you've got things like the moon landing theories, you know, the classic conspiracy theory, which is different to some because you've actually got all this visual evidence that, of course, now with today's analysis techniques, people are pulling them apart and finding what they claim are all kinds of interesting things. So they are quite interesting because it isn't just reliant on one or two people's testimony who could be lying. You know, there are things that everybody can look at and can have an opinion on, but then you find even then the interpretations of what they're looking at, of course, that can create huge rifts even amongst the conspiracy community, if you like, itself. So that's the thing, you're getting everybody to absolutely agree on what this is and what that is. It's not always so easy, but it's never been easy.
Looking, let's do a little bit of the history then, and look at some cases which are celebrated and well-known, and some that maybe people tend to forget. Like the sinking of the Lusitania. Now, this was seen to be a propaganda coup, and you say in the book it's easy to see why some today believe it was no mere coincidence that such a sensitive event took place so early in the conflict, asserting that it was specifically contrived to help escalate what was going on. Just let's put it into context for those who don't know, don't remember, what was the Lusitania and how did it come to be sunk?
So the Lusitania was one of our liners, and she would happily go back and forth across the Atlantic, and of course would therefore often have Americans on board. But by 1915, of course, we were now in World War One. America was trying to stay out of that war. So people were worried that the ship could be attacked by U-boats, and German U-boats were, you know, right across the Atlantic. So what we would do is always make sure that when the Lusitania came into British waters, we would send out warship escorts just to guard it, to see it safely into harbour. And yet, mysteriously, one day, the warship escorts just peeled away. Off they went, no signal, no explanation, and Lusitania was left very vulnerable, and within a matter of hours was torpedoed, and down it went. And I mean, it was a terrible atrocity. Around 1,200 people more died in that sinking. But of course, it had huge propaganda value, because the Americans, who'd been trying to keep out of the war, now had lost a lot of their own people, and it was one of the first steps that would help bring them in. It wasn't the only thing, other things occur, but it would make Americans feel much more that they ought to get involved. The problem comes with this as to who gave the orders to leave that ship vulnerable. And it's generally assumed it would have been the First Lord of the Admiralty. Now, that's a problem for some people, because at this stage, the First Lord of the Admiralty was Winston Churchill, who, of course, is a great hero to many people. But, you know, we need to acknowledge in the conspiracy world, he is often seen as a bit of a ruthless New World Order operative who would do perhaps what was necessary rather than what was morally right. And it's certainly the case that he had written a letter to a colleague only a few weeks before Lusitania went down, in which he expressed basically that there was a need for one of these ships to go down because of the propaganda value that it would have. And I think the phrase is, if some of the shipping gets into trouble, better still. So many see that as a very suspicious indication that perhaps on his watch he enabled a ship to be left vulnerable, and indeed it had the result that many people had thought that it would.
Or indeed, maybe it was just a sad coincidence and one of those things that happen in war, but it's very hard to know, isn't it? How long did it take, as far as you're aware, for people to stop reporting the event or stop taking in the details of that event and start to speculate about what might be behind the event?
I think the speculation actually began quite early on. And one of the other strange things about Lusitania was that, of course, we had promoted it as purely a civilian vessel, but actually it did have arms on board. That was one of the reasons the Germans had said, they had openly said they would target it because it was carrying armaments. Now, we had claimed that wasn't true, but it turns out it was true. So the Germans were actually correct about that. And indeed, the Germans had put out a warning in the American press that people people basically shouldn't get on board this ship. Now, it doesn't make what they did any more right, or indeed allowing this to happen if it did any more right. But, you know, there were clear signals that there was something not quite about this ship, as we've been told. So, yes, and I think that, you know, there was strangeness to some of the explosions. Some wondered, as it went down, as it was exploding, as it sank, were they armaments going up, or was it just purely a natural reaction of the ship's engines? And these were arguments, yeah, that you know, literally came up very, very quickly. And you often find that there is a view that conspiracy thinking is applied in retrospect, but actually often when you look back, and JFK is a classic example, you find people at the time immediately were asking questions.
Interesting, you know, isn't it? Because, you know, it's before my time, and I've often wondered how soon was it before people started to say, there's something fishy about this.
Sure. Well, I mean, take JFK. So the idea, and this is the central argument about that conspiracy, is that other gunmen must have been present. I mean, if you say that Oswald could not have fired as many shots with the particular gun that he had in the time that he had, and that's where the arguments revolve around, you then have to think that there could have been other gunmen. But we've been told for a while that that's a sort of a retrospective theory. But you can find minutes of speeches made literally weeks after the shooting in which people are openly referring to the presence of other gunmen. So it was pretty much an open secret that at the very least this was a theory that was, you know, well known about even at the time. So that didn't just come along when we all got paranoid in the 1970s.
So that's interesting. So that arose from the mechanics of the event. In other words, people starting to say, that's an event that could not happen in that way. I mean, look, I'm sure you'll know this name, but sadly he's no longer with us. I spent a very interesting hour in the company of the late Jim Mars, who was very much on the case of the John F. Kennedy assassination. And while we were talking, recording, he actually had a rifle of a similar kind and tried just out of interest to you know, loose off as many imaginary shots as Lee Harvey Oswald was said to have loosed off from that floor of the Texas Book Depository, and he couldn't do it. But it's not just him who couldn't do it. We're talking about experts who couldn't do it. So, for starters, the mechanics of the event posed their own questions.
That's right. And I think also when the bizarreness of it really became clear was when the Warren Commission, that was the commission set up to investigate this and was clearly always intended to be a whitewash, when it released diagrams, for instance, showing one bullet, the so-called magic bullet, doing an awful lot of damage and passing through two people.
Well, a lot of revolutions and convolutions that bullet was supposed to have done.
Yes, exactly right. And many ballistics experts say that's absolutely not possible, certainly not with the gun we're told he was using. Although, even there's no agreement. The gun that we are told that Oswald was using is not the same gun that the people claim they initially found when they first discovered the room he'd been shooting from. So there's almost nothing that anybody can agree on. And that's always a sure sign that, A, there is probably something dubious going on, but B, that it will probably never get settled. And some people think that when people are setting up conspiracies, they deliberately see very confusing things in because they know that there's going to be so much to deal with later on. Nobody's ever going to agree on
that. Well, that's something I was going to bring in. You know, the JFK case is a perfect example of what use are conspiracy theories. Well, I would argue that they're useful because they make people question the event and who would stand to benefit from the gain. You know, follow the money, follow the chain kind of thing, which goes for many events. But the fact of the matter is, we're never going to get a definitive answer, I don't think, now, because a lot of the people who went through that awful day and that awful era are not with us anymore. And, you know, even their relatives who they might have spoken to directly are starting to be not with us anymore. So we're never going to get a definitive answer, and yet new aspects of this come out all the time. The latest one, I'm sure you're aware of, was that there was a theory that JFK was shot from the front, was shot from within the vehicle, maybe shot by accident.
Sure. I mean, to be fair, I mean, even that's not really a new theory, because the late Bill Cooper, who was a well-known conspiracy theorist, who himself got shot dead some years ago, he had long advocated that one of the shots had actually come from the driver, a man called William Greer. Now, many theorists, they don't agree with that. But then this idea came out, and people like Channel 5 had put this out, that a security guard's pistol accidentally went off while the melee was occurring.
That's what I'm thinking,
and that was the extra shot. But of course, many other people see that as in itself a kind of a deflection story. You know, that's trying to put you off the scent of other official gunmen, if you know what I mean. Because of course, the minute you say there were other gunmen who were part of a wider conspiracy, you then have to ask who they were and who they were working for. And that then takes you down a very dark and dubious rabbit hole.
And this is the problem. Nobody has the resources, I think, and bearing in mind that history is making this cloudier all the time, to follow all of the various leads. Like, you know, there is the theory again that there were two Lee Harvey Oswalds, you know, and that they were in different places.
Yes.
There are so many questions about that, that, you know, I've read and seen so much about that, that my personal belief, but I'll never be able to 100% prove it, is that JFK was also shot from the grassy knoll for any one of five or six different reasons that that conspiracy theorists or theorists of various kinds have come up with, that he'd upset various people from the mafia to Castro to the military-industrial complex, you name it, it's there.
Yeah, there were people queuing up wanting to get rid of him. So there's no shortage of a list of potential enemies. I think the interesting thing, though, is although we say it will never get resolved, and I'm sure it won't, that doesn't mean it hasn't been resolved. There's a lot of ideas out there with a lot of very good evidence that certainly makes extremely good cases. But you don't then hear about them in the definitive record because they can't give you the 100% verification. Until the day we invent a time machine and go and look back, we won't know. So in the end, it drifts. And there is a general feeling that this goes on today, that something that is a conspiracy, very likely, it's almost like they rely on the fact that in the end the arguments will get so convoluted that we'll all just move on and not worry too much more about it. And that, I think, is something that they rely on. And the public does have a very short memory. So with JFK, I think most people, when you look at the polls, believe it was a coup d'etat of some kind. But then it comes to a point where, well, it doesn't really affect anyone's lives. Let's move on. And I think that happens all the time with things that really we probably should get to the bottom of. And maybe the evidence is there in plain sight, but it's just getting everybody to agree at a time when it can all come to a head, and so often that never occurs, sadly.
And some conspiracy theories just run out of steam, I think. And yeah, I can remember the many conspiracy theories or views of the death of Princess Diana that were current, and some people were suggesting all sorts of things. And what I do suspect is that there are aspects of the story that maybe were not properly reported, and there are details of the story that we may never know. But there were people who were suggesting that her death was not an accident. Now, that one, unlike JFK, seems to me to have very much gone on the furthest of back burners. So some conspiracy theories don't have longevity.
Well, they do and they don't. I mean, in my conspiracies book, I write at some length about the Princess Diana case, because it's one of those things where you can't say necessarily clearly Princess Diana was assassinated, which is what some people believe. But you can say, I think, pretty factually, there are many strange things about her death. And that's where you have to leave it. And in fact, when you look at polls as to what the public believes, you find that actually most of us are conspiracy theorists when it comes to people like Princess Diana. The general view is she actually was bumped off. And you get a similar poll result with Dr. David Kelly. Now, that's irrespective of whether it's been proven or not. There's a feeling in the collective gut, and I think that's often quite powerful, that says there's something wrong here. And people know can't go further than that.
I'm sure that does flag up in opinion polls. I'm not sure to the overwhelming extent that you suggest, I may be wrong about that. Dr. David Kelly, that case you mentioned, and of course with this you mention that the point at which people who ask questions about a case become labelled as conspiracy theorists. Now, there was an MP, former MP, Norman Baker, who I've actually interviewed about other things, who wrote a book about the Dr. David Kelly case, the man who was the Iraq whistleblower, who was found dead. And you know, a lot of people had many views, still have many views about that, many of which are very compelling. Lots of unanswered questions about that. But Norman Baker wrote a book asking questions, but found himself by some labelled as a conspiracy theorist.
He did. I mean, this is complete chance, but Norman was actually my MP for a while, and I knew him, and he's one of the few MPs where I could actually say I felt that he was of impeccable sort of like reliability. And I think if he believes something, there would be a good reason to believe it. And anybody that's not read his book, The Strange Death of David Kelly, I really would recommend that you do. But you're quite right. Even though he presented extremely good evidence into the mainstream, he was then accused of being associated with lots of other wild thinking. And I remember distinctly, I think he was on Newsnight when good old Jeremy Paxman used to be on, and Paxman just said in a flippant way, "Oh, well, you'd find conspiracy in a cup of tea," which really wasn't fair on poor Norman Baker at all. But yeah, that's how they dismiss things. You just associate one belief, however reasonable, with all the perhaps slightly more shadowy areas, and then you're taken down by association. But that is a technique that I think goes on a lot.
Conspiracy theorist is a label that some people apply with a very dirty brush to people who don't really deserve to be branded conspiracy theorists. You know, I think you're right, we have to be able to ask questions. If you get into a situation where you can't ask questions, you're in big trouble, I would say.
Well, we covered in the earlier segment the fact that if you look at the technical description of what a conspiracy theorist is, what's the problem? The way I always feel about this, if anybody knows the religious group, the Quakers, people forget that the word Quaker was an insult, and they were originally called the Religious Society of Friends, but it was like, oh, you lot, look at you, quaking in the sight of God. And they thought, you know what, yeah, all right, we're Quakers. And it kind of neutralized the attacks, really. And I often think if somebody calls you a conspiracy theorist, if you've got a good reason to be one, just say, yeah, and here are the reasons why. And then the other person often goes, oh, right, okay. So although it's become a term of abuse, I don't know, I think it's getting weak. And now when you look at the numbers of people that do believe in them, which is why they keep having to take them offline and deplatform them, there's going to come a day at this rate where there's as many conspiracy believers as there are, shall we say, mainstream believers. And that's going to be an interesting day.
Hold that thought, Andy Thomas. We're talking Conspiracy Theories with Andy Thomas here at The Unexplained. Stay here.
Online, on DAB, and on the Talk Radio app. Talk Radio. Online, on DAB, and on the Talk Radio app. Talk Radio. The Unexplained with Howard Hughes on Talk Radio.
Andy Thomas here. He's done what I think is a very brave thing, research into conspiracy theories, because as we know, one person's conspiracy theory is another person's absolute truth or total and utter nonsense. Maybe the fact, and I wonder what you think about this, Andy, that we can have opposing views like that means that we really are in a democracy.
I think one of the problems of the age, and I intend to write more about this, is polarization. Because, you know, we've seen left versus right, leave versus remain, black versus white, and so on. People have got into very entrenched camps. And that's also happened between, you know, those that believe that conspiracies are fake news and those in the conspiracy camp. And people in the end start shouting at each other across a huge divide. And then you stop debating evidence. And I think that is a real shame. So I think that, yes, we do live in a democracy, but at the moment, you've got a lot of people shouting at each other and not having nuanced debate. And I think that's a serious problem. And you see that in microcosm in the conspiracy world, where even within conspiracy belief sort of factions themselves, they get into arguments. So, for instance, 9/11, Everybody in that world would agree that it's the official story is not true. But then they argue about what bits aren't true and how were the buildings brought down? And then they get into very vicious kind of cycles with that. We've seen that with the pandemic. Those that believe that pandemic is misrepresented as opposed to those that actually believe the whole thing's a hoax. But then the ones that think it's a hoax accuse the ones that do believe there is a reality to it of being soft. And before you know it, there are conflicts erupting. So we have that within their own worlds, but then we have, yeah, the mainstream versus the conspiracy world. And nobody listens to each other. I know that really is distressing.
Well, I think that's something that, you know, I like people to get on together. And I'm sad to see the world becoming so polarized. And yes, there are people who email me regularly who tell me that, you know, the whole pandemic is a put-up job, it's all a hoax. But, you know, what one has to say to them is that, well, people are dying from this. And what would it be? What would be in it for, you know, the scientists and doctors and surgeons and people like that who confirm that people are dying from this? Why would they be not telling the truth about that? You know, of course they must be, I would say. Although I'm going to get emails about saying that now. I worry about everything. I just want, for the record, let's say it very clearly as those people start to write emails to me. I just want people to get together in a spirit of cooperation. Because we, the ordinary people, are the ones who are at the sharp end of this pandemic. And, you know, talk together rather than fight. It seems to me that people are just fighting now.
I mean, I do know some very good, wonderful people that do believe that the pandemic is a hoax. I don't personally, but I do think that there are certain things you can identify that are not quite right. The way they are compiling the figures is questionable in some ways. There are reasons to wonder if the test itself is picking up on the right thing. Now, even members of SAGE have come forward and implied that, but you then don't hear much more about it. So the thing is, I can understand why people do need to express their feelings. But yeah, then you get into the problem where somebody will come back and say, well, there haven't been any deaths. All the deaths are from other means. You've just been told to believe it's COVID. And then the minute you get onto that, you can't go anywhere with it because that's their view. And you see how this then becomes a problem. Whereas others are saying, well, hold on a minute. No, I think there could be something to this. It is real. But yeah, maybe we need to know more. But then they get shouted down. And so the whole thing tumbles in. And then they're all just brushed away as being mad conspiracy theorists.
And the problem is sometimes claims that are made are later explained, but you get to hear the claim more loudly than the explanation. There was a case, I think, quite recently where there was, you know, it was being put about that I think flu figures and COVID-19 figures, I think I'm right in saying this, were being conflated together, were being agglomerated together in a way they shouldn't have been. And it was later fact-checked and proved that that's not the case.
Well, that's one of those things where, yes, okay, so it is true that they are compiling the figures together, but they are keeping them in separate columns.
Yes.
But so,
well,
so, yes,
well, then they're separate
so,
figures then, aren't they?
There's a truth to it, but it's misinterpreted. But the reason that people would misinterpret that is fear of being misled, and I think that's very deep, because we do know there are some areas where the truth has not been told. People are always going to worry, therefore, that anything they're told might not be true. And although I understand why some people get very cross at people going with conspiracy theories, I do also understand the other side of this, that people feel, hang on a minute, we're often not told the truth. Why shouldn't we ask these questions? So it's enabling a debate in a forum that is fair and balanced that I think would be a very healthy thing. But the people that feel that they want to have that, they get shut down and are just brushed away as fanatics. And look, there are always extreme elements. We know this in any area of interest. But at the moment, yeah, it's all being pushed into one bucket and they're trying to stick the lid on it very tightly, and I don't think in the end that helps, and it doesn't make the doubts go away, and then you get more extreme elements therefore trying to assert their doubts, and then you get things like people like, you know, allegedly at least setting fire to 5G towers and all the rest of it, and then you get that more extreme action. So that's the problem. If you don't let somebody have a voice, they will shout all the louder to try and have that voice.
You make what I think is a very, very, very good point about all of this that I've never really thought of. This is an argument for those who lead us and those who are in positions of power to tell the truth on a consistent basis. Because you've only got to lie to the people, or what was that word that was once used, that phrase, be economical with the truth. That's going back to the 1980s, but it's a great phrase. You've only got to lie or be economical with the truth once, and then people question everything you say. And that's part of our issue. You know, who could say that politicians don't lie? Sometimes they do. Sometimes they varnish the truth. Sometimes they present the facts in ways that are perhaps misleading. And sometimes what they say could be construed to be a lie. And you only have to start going down that road. And you can't wonder, you can't question why conspiracy theories arise. Because you're not being, in every case, absolutely straight up with the people.
I think that's true. Plus, we've seen very good examples of this recently. You're having people in positions of power not following their own rules. Dominic Cummings and his weird travels in the lockdown. This new Scottish MP recently, you know, who had COVID and still travelled. All the things they've told other people not to do. And I think the minute you start doing that, so on one level, you can just say they're hypocrites. But the other problem is it makes some people think, well, actually, what they're telling us isn't even true. They know that there's no threat from this. And before you know it, you've undermined the whole fabric of trust in authority. So, and that, and the fact that they clearly do tell lies, is always a problem. It's always been a problem, as we've mentioned earlier. You name any period of history. But now, we like to hope that we've got to a level where they'd be a bit more straight with us, but apparently not. And therefore, for them to condemn conspiracy thinking isn't fair, because they do invite it, sadly, with their own behaviour.
But sometimes, when you talk about alternative views of what happens, you get into situations that there's probably never going to be an answer to. We talked about JFK. People will be coming out about about that forever, for as long as you and I are both alive. The Oklahoma bombing you've got in the book, April 1995, disaffected veteran Timothy McVeigh drove a Ryder hire truck with explosives into downtown Oklahoma City, destroyed a federal office building, 168 people died. It was a terrible, terrible event. But the Guardian newspaper, I was going back through some of the archives about this today, and I thought, well, this is weird, and then it made me start to think about this. Timothy McVeigh was pulled over near the Kansas border and arrested alone at the wheel of a glaringly improbable getaway car, an old rust bucket of a Mercury sedan with no license plates, which absolutely made him a sitting target for being pulled over by any police patrol officer who happened to be around. You could build a whole conspiracy theory about that.
Well, and indeed, of course, people have. There is a pattern, it must be said, of events where there seems to be a stand down or a deliberate allowing of people to carry out atrocities. And this is something, again, which you can see throughout history. But it's quite disturbing. And we know this. You know, when somebody commits a terror attack, it then turns out that actually they were known about quite early on. Now, of course, you could just say it's just kind of police incompetence. But when that pattern starts to happen too much, you will understand why people believe these events are at the very least allowed or encouraged to happen to foment some state of emergency whereby controls can then be brought in. And that's the classic conspiracy equation. And that's what's happening with the pandemic, which is that it's being used, in their view, to create a state of emergency whereby we give in to controls that will never be given back and that we're all going to wind up living in police states. Hmm. And sadly, there is some observable truth to that. And you have to hope that it will be pulled back from. But what I'm just saying is these are the fears. Mm, it's very deep rooted in the conspiracy
world. I understand,
world.
But you have to say that it's a hell of a length to go to, you know, if you were following that line of thought. I'm sure it could be done in much simpler ways than a global pandemic. It sounds strange to my small brain. Very finally, we've only got a couple of minutes, and it's not really fair to ask you to talk about this in 2 minutes, but let's try. QAnon. I only became aware of QAnon, you know, in the last year or so when people started asking me about it. But, I mean, here is the set of conspiracy theories that is shifting like the sands of the desert. You know, it's not people who say they buy into QAnon are not talking about the same things as they were talking about at the beginning. This is the conspiracy theory that you can pack anything into.
Yeah, I mean, that in itself makes some people suspicious because, so QAnon, if anybody's listening and isn't sure, it's allegedly a movement of whistleblowers in the deep state in America who are essentially pro-Trump and anti-New World Order. And they believe that Trump is actually trying to destroy the New World Order and reveal paedophile networks and all of this. So that's the idea. But of course, there are other people that believe that QAnon actually is just a very far right-wing organization that is putting out lies to justify what it wants to put out there. The trouble we've got now is that what the media, sorry to keep criticizing media, but what the media often do is they are saying anybody with any belief that borders on conspiracy theory is basically the same as QAnon, and they're trying to sort of push it all back into that corner. And that really isn't true at all. Yes, there are some people whose views might be part of what QAnon believes, but often it's not the case. And it's huge. I mean, QAnon is huge in America, and it's now becoming a front, if you like, the front for those with conspiracy beliefs, those with concerns about vaccination and the pandemic and so on. And the problem with that is that it all gets very sort of black and white. And if QAnon were shown at some point to be a hoax, which some worry that it might be, of course, all of the good things that have now been associated with it will all be taken down in one go. And some worry that the whole QAnon thing is in itself a plot to diminish sort of the credibility of conspiracies. So there are, again, conspiracy theories within conspiracy theories then. But I don't think that anybody should say that just because you believe in a conspiracy theory, you therefore support QAnon, because that certainly isn't the case at all.
And I have to say that to my listener, some of my listeners anyway, you know, I haven't been sitting here for the last hour knocking down conspiracy theories. That's not the case, but we have to be able to talk about them. I think that is the case. And I think that a lot of this, as we said at the beginning of this, it comes down to education. Let's keep free speech, let's keep people putting out within reason, within the law, putting out their opinions on how things and why things happen. But let's just make sure that people are educated to be discerning and to look for sources of fact. And in fact, those who put things out there maybe should do a little bit more to justify them with solid references and real people that we can refer to. And then we might get somewhere. And I still will never believe that a lone gunman shot JFK. I'm afraid that that's one conspiracy theory that I'm completely believing is fact, but I'm sure somebody's going to tell me that I'm wrong about that. Andy Thomas, thank you very much. If people want to go online and find out about you, your work, where would they go? Where would they visit?
Sure. Do have a look at my website, which is truthagenda.org, truthagenda.org. You'll find out lots of information about my books, Conspiracies and the Truth Agenda and other books, and lots of videos to watch, articles to read, covering all of this ground and more. So yeah, truthagenda.org, and you can find the books on Amazon as well. Very easy to find.
Great to talk with you, Andy. The hardest conversation to have, because either of us, anything that we say, somebody's going to hate it.
that's the way of it.
That just goes with the territory. And, you know, I'm a nice guy who likes being on the radio, enjoys what he does. That's all I am. Thank you very much, Andy. And thank you very much to you for being part of this. Thank you to producer Reese for his hard work this week. Paul Ross is next here on Talk Radio. So until next week, meet here on The Unexplained on the radio. Please stay safe. Please stay calm. And above all, please stay in touch. Thank you very much. Take care. Good night.
Talk Radio. Across the UK. Online. On DAB. And on your smart speaker. The Unexplained. With Howard Hughes. On Talk Radio. Talk Radio. Radio.